This is my top table at the Waitrose Cookery School. He's the boy from the council estate who now owns the only pub in the world with two Michelin stars. My top table guest today is Tom Kerridge. Tom, good day to you.
Hello.
Now, listen, let's talk about those two Michelin stars because, I mean, it's an appropriate reward for your talent. But there's a greater significance, it seems to me, in that for the first time ever, you've been put on a par with haute cuisine. Now, how do you see that significance?
OK, so I don't, my view on Michelin, and I think, is it's a phenomenal award to have achieved, and it's a huge, it's a massive team effort to have got it. There's a lot of people involved to have got to that point. And it's not really something that we've consciously chased. We just want to get better every day at what we've done at the pub, and I've surrounded myself by some amazing people. But the Michelin Award itself, I think, is, everyone associates Michelin with expensive and expensive ingredients and French waiting staff and, like you say, haute cuisine. But I don't think that's Michelin's fault. I think what happens is, in the 80s, when I started looking at being a chef, late 80s, thinking this is a cool career, this is something I could do, all the best chefs in the country were working in the best places. And the best places were posh hotels or very nice restaurants like the Gavroche for the Roux brothers and things like that. And those, that association with French cuisine was always about expensive ingredients. So lobster, beef fillet, foie gras, caviar, truffles, all that sort of stuff was associated with cuisine. And the best chefs were cooking in it and the worst chefs weren't cooking in those sort of places. And what's happened is through those generations now, you can see there's almost like a family tree of people starting from the Roux brothers all the way down, filtering down. And more chefs have now started cooking with less expensive ingredients, but with the same quality of touch, the same style of cooking, the same understanding of the ingredient. For example, a fillet of beef is great, but that animal still has a shin as well. So if you cook the shin of beef with the same love, attention and care as you're cooking the fillet of beef, there's no reason why Michelin shouldn't award something that's slightly cheaper and something more.
So therefore, it's significant of a wider issue in our eating habits, basically.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the understanding that more and more people eat out now and more people have an understanding of food. So when you eat out, you have a that everyday that you want to, if you want to go out for something to eat on a Tuesday, not wearing a shirt and tie, then that's cool. Whereas before, eating out was seen as a special occasion, only birthdays and anniversaries and Valentine's Day. Yes. Now more and more people go out and eat on an everyday occasion, and there's so many good places to eat these days.
Well, it's interesting when you look back on your career, though, because, I mean, the situation you are now, the love you have for the job, one imagines that you had this ambition as a child right the way through. But in fact, that wasn't true. I mean, you're a latchkey kid, weren't you? And that's how you learned how to cook. You cooked for your mum, was that
working? Yeah, that's it. Yeah, I mean, I was a single-parent family, and I used to come home, and my mum would have two jobs, bless her heart. She worked very hard for the council as a secretary, and then she would go and wash up in a pub in an evening or work some, you know, some other job 2 or 3 days a week. And I would come in and I'd cook tea for my brother. And it actually wasn't a love of cooking, but it was the first time, I suppose, that I turned an oven on was age 14. And I'd burn fish finger sandwiches or make beans on toast. And then I started sticking a bit of curry powder in the baked beans and things like that. So that kind of is where I got my first taste of cooking. It wasn't my gran teaching me to make a cake and licking the cake bowl, kind of that romantic fun of it. It was through necessity, I suppose, that I turned an oven on in the first place.
And like many chefs that I've interviewed too, I mean, you're spectacularly unsuccessful at school. You didn't like school. You left at 15.
Actually, not liking school. I loved school, but it wasn't not for the learning point of view. It was great because I was there with all my mates having a laugh. and that point of view, I'm quite a sociable person. I like being around people, and school was great because I was around. It was an all-boys comprehensive school in the middle of kind of like three estates in Gloucester. So there was a lot of naughty boys there, and it was a really good crack to be a part of.
What's a naughty boy?
Well, like naughty boys that quite often then didn't go to school. We spent a lot of the time actually around my mum's house while she was at work watching the telly and smoking fags and things like that. So it was rather than being at school. School was. Academic-wise, it wasn't really... I did all right, like, but it wasn't something... Education was... I did want to go on to further education. I wanted to get out and do stuff.
But you went into the theatre.
I did, yeah.
You were an actor for a while.
I was. I call them kind of my DOS years, between 16 and 18, I think. I left school and I joined a youth theatre. My mum kind of encouraged me to join a youth theatre with one of my friends. And it wasn't really on purpose. I ended up there and an agent came to see somebody else that was in a show, and then she decided to take me on. And then about 3 weeks after being in this youth theatre, I was filming the Christmas special of Miss Marple, playing a kid in a borstal, like in a borstal school. And then I did something in London's Burning where I played Thug One. I played a bully in a kid's TV show. I played a thief in something else. And I thought, between the ages of 16 and 18, I've already been typecast as a bully and a thief and a thug. So I thought, it wasn't really for me, but it was a great thing to do between the ages of 16 and 18.
Well, there's a great link between showbiz and what you do.
Yeah.
I mean, there is. I mean, there's presentation. It's all about that, isn't it? It's all about theatre.
It is,
you go to a decent pub, a decent restaurant to eat. I mean, that's what it's about.
Yeah, and I think it also helps to give you confidence with people. I think if you're having to talk and perform, maybe in front of a camera or on a stage, it gives you the opportunity as a chef. I mean, being a chef in this modern day and age, you have to be able to communicate with people. I don't mean just in media-wise, I just mean in terms of customers. Well, customers expect some form of interaction, and if you're there to be able to speak to them and explain dishes, it's very important rather than being...
And also deal with complaints. I mean...
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I know. I mean, gosh, I mean, I don't know how you keep your temper. Do you keep your temper? I mean, is the chef always right?
No, the chef's not always right, but the customer isn't always right either. And I know that's quite a controversial thing to say, but the best thing about TV cookery shows and food magazines and you know everything that goes on in the media regarding food is that people learn more about food, which is amazing, which is incredible. But it also means that they have larger opinions of what they think is right and is wrong. So, but that for us is fantastic because it drives the standard of food up in restaurants because you can't get away with stuff now. People, you know, customers understand what a chef is doing a lot more.
But there must be always the temptation with someone like you, as successful as you being the two Michelin stars, to actually expand. Mm. There must be siren calls all the time. Why do you open here? Why do you open there?
Yeah.
And so far you've resisted that, haven't you? You've kept just the hand and flowers and you've done your books, doing your TV show, and seem to be very, very contented.
Yeah, I'm so happy in doing... I never intended... When you become a chef in the first place, you're not... You don't... When I walked into a kitchen as an 18-year-old, it wasn't because I wanted to make TV or write books or become a millionaire. It's because I got in there and there were naughty boys that I kind of went to school with knives and fire, and they were all in a kitchen and they all drove mental cars that they souped up themselves. They all had really loud stereos. I was like, I love this environment. I want to be a part of this. And that's what I wanted to be a part of, and I love being a part of that. And the way that it's grown and the way that Hand of Flowers has grown. We looked seriously last year at opening somewhere in London, and it just didn't feel right. Like I say, we've grown wonderfully as a team. I've surrounded myself by... The Hand of Flowers is a team. It's like a big family of people that work there, and people have been with us for so long, which is, in an industry where chefs and waiters is very transient, they move all the time.
Yes,
we keep a very good core team of people, and we've grown. And if I was to open somewhere in London, it would just be a second sight of a different bunch of people that isn't the same. We're a family and we grow and we will do something else. I mean, I'm not interested in world domination in restaurants. I'm interested in enjoying myself, making sure everyone has a lovely time. And as long as I can keep my wife happy and go on holiday once a year, we're all right. That's all we need.
I wonder though if this celebrity lifestyle and all that will allow you to do that. I mean, the pressure on you all the time must be, why don't you open here? Why don't you go to Sydney?
Yeah.
I mean, that's my idea. I mean, Sydney's a great place. It loves pubs.
Yeah.
Aussies love pubs.
Yeah, yeah.
You do incredibly well there.
Yeah.
Can I come as your partner?
Yeah. And that's a big... Well, this is your business plan pitching to me. I like this.
Exactly. That's the way the television works now. Yeah.
I think it's because the other thing about pubs and restaurants, and as you know yourself, there's always an issue with staff.
Mm.
So investing in people and investing in a lot of people, there's always issue. And somebody explained to me the other day that if you want to make a small fortune out of being a restaurateur, get yourself a large fortune and open a restaurant. And you go, okay. So the idea of trying to open somewhere with a load of other staff, and you're always, you always end up being a mum and a dad to a member of staff and a counsellor and a someone who lends money and somebody. And the idea of opening another place and another place and another place and finding all those wonderful people again, it's very difficult. For me to lock myself away in a room for a couple of months and write a book, it's probably, as a business plan, it makes more sense because I'm just investing in me rather than another 50 people or more. I just find it easier.
Yeah.
I've only got a very small brain, so it's a lot easier to cope on my own rather than worrying about everyone else.
Anyway, now, you're going to make me a what? What's the...
Spaghetti bolognese. Oh. We're going to do spaghetti bolognese. Yeah.
Is it going to be a special one? I mean...
Well, I hope so. Yeah, I hope so. It's one of the first things that my mum actually showed me how to do. So it's just a very simple bolognese recipe that I've kind of changed up and done a few little bits to accentuate every kind of bit of ingredient along the way to make it a little bit more special.
So this is spag bol time.
Beef-based spaghetti bolognese.
I was hoping for wild boar.
We can change.
No, I'm so used to that. All right, fine, OK then. Then I'm going to be your kitchen hand. What do I have to do first?
OK, first thing we're going to do is we can get the pasta cooking. So if you can open the spaghetti for me.
And you reckon, I've never done this before, but you reckon you just bash it?
I can't believe you know it. One-handed.
What? Oh, Christ.
And then bang it on there and it'll stick out. It's a cool thing to do. Hey, Arlo.
Hey, look at that.
I'll stick about half of it in. So whilst you're doing that...
Yep.
I'm going to get on and roast some of the vegetables. Let me grab that oil.
Do we need to turn it when it's in submerged, or just leave it?
Yeah, we'll just leave it there and it'll come back up to the boil and then you can give it a little bit of a stir every now and then.
Okay.
And just get it moving.
Good.
Some chopped onions, clove of garlic. I mean, a good bolognese sauce is like a ragu, you know. It's stewed for a long, long time, so all those flavours kind of break down anyway. Some diced carrot.
So you've had a particular fondness for this dish throughout your life, then. That's one of the reasons why you're cooking it.
It's one of the first dishes that my mum taught me to cook.
Uh-huh.
And it's...
What's she a good cook, your mum?
Yeah, she's very good. She's very good at just, a good roast dinner and a good... She's always have attempts at making a good pudding and she was always good at doing cooking dishes that, you know, shepherd's pie, cottage pie. She's a very good home cook.
And now you're in the family. How much are you cooking for?
Just myself and my brother. So there was only the three of us. My mum, myself and my brother. So that was it.
You'd probably eat your own body weight, wouldn't you, and your brother?
Oh, yeah. My brother's a big lad as well. Well, I say a big lad. He's 6'5", but he's thin as a rake. So I got all the chunk. He got the little bit, but he's just a little bit taller. Pancetta as well into there. And we're just going to slowly sweat it all down and all that bacon fat will come out. And all those flavours will start emulsifying together. This wasn't in the original recipe with me mum's. This is a new thing that I've added. So the good thing about cooking like this is the way that I cook is we try to accentuate the flavour of everything. Mm-hmm. So something that's very simple, we try to make better and better and better.
Yes.
So we look for layers and layers of flavour. So one of it is the pancetta starts in there and you get the flavour of pork and the lovely bacon fat that comes out. And then the stewed vegetables and the garlic and the bay leaves, some oregano, dried oregano. And then the roasted mince. So what we've done here, now, a lot of people when they make bolognese will then just put raw mince into this bit now, stir it, and it goes all grey and all a bit stewy and a bit... Now, some of the best flavours of meat is the outside crispy bit, even if it's nice and pink in the middle, but slow-cooked roasted meat, that's where the flavour comes from, the almost caramelised burnt crispy bits. And I've roasted this in an oven with a little muslin bag here, and in there I've got some star anise and some cloves. And to go in with that, we're going to put the tomato sauce. Now, the tomato sauce, we're not using tinned tomatoes at all. This is going to be your job. We're not using tinned tomatoes. We're using tomatoes that we've just cut in half. I sprinkle them with a bit of salt and a bit of sugar and put through the oven. And what that does is it kind of intensifies the flavour.
Okay.
So, if you can put them in that jug blender and blend them, that would be amazing.
It will be. How do I switch it on, first of all?
Are you not much of a cook at home?
No. I didn't know what this was, actually. do you put the stuff in first?
The whole thing in. Let me do that. Just all of it. Seeds.
All of it.
Seeds, the whole lot. We're going to blend the whole lot. Right. That's it, perfect.
Okay. How's this open?
Don't worry, I'm kitchen savvy. I know what I'm doing. It's just all about strength. That's what it is. That's okay, so into here, red wine vinegar is going to go into the ragu here. A good splash. And what we're going to do is we're going to reduce that down with a little bit of brown sugar. And what that does is it almost gives kind of a sweet and sour, pickly kind of underlying flavour to it. Good splash of red wine.
Good.
And then some beef stock. And we're just going to bring that up to the boil. And then into that, we're going to put the little muslin bag. This is just tied together of star anise and cloves. And then the roasted beef. Now, all of this roasted beef, all of that is lovely. Loads and loads of flavour. Look, you can, where it's crunchy, you just know it's going to be delicious. So that's gone into there. And then your tomato puree, if you can see that, you've made this beautiful roasted tomato.
This is my contribution.
This is your contribution.
Mm-hmm.
And it gets poured in on top.
Should I stir it?
Yeah, give it a good stir.
Good stir.
And then into the ragu, I'm going to put some button mushrooms.
Okay.
I'm just going to chop a bit of fresh sage here. Fresh sage, fresh oregano, all those kind of good, strong Italian herbs. And the reason why I think a lot of these dishes are great for Great Britain in this country is they're Roman-style dishes, you know, when the hardy herbs, hard winter dishes.
Mm.
You know, not all of Italy is nice, warm coastal,
no,
is
not,
it?
So, no.
Should we have a little look at this pasta?
How do you tell? Just by the texture.
Just by texture.
Yeah. So that's a bit al dente, isn't
no,
it?
No, that's perfect. That's beautiful. Oh. That's lovely. So what we'll do is we'll drain this. I'll do this. Don't want to splash any water on your pink shirt.
Give me my bad pink shirt.
So we'll drain the pasta. And then what I'll do is I'm going to shake it off. Put it all back in there with a little bit of the cooking water. There's just a little bit of the water left in it.
Mm.
We'll stick in a little bit of butter that we can toss about in. And then into that, some cracked pepper. And then what we've got is a ragu there that's already been done in best.
Well,
here's one
that
I made earlier form. It's been cooking. This has been cooking for about 2 hours, 2.5 hours.
Uh-huh.
And then we'll put a little bit of the pasta with the pepper on it. And then we'll put a big spoonful of this ragu on top. There's a bay leaf that's sticking out. Don't worry, you haven't got to eat the bay leaf. And then on top of that, we can have fresh Parmesan. Sprinkle that on the top. And there is a slow-cooked spaghetti bolognese, like my mum kind of used to make.
Mm. That's exceptional. It's lovely, isn't it? It really is.
All those little bits of underlying flavours.
All the tastes, all the flavours in there. Mm.
The little bits of roasted meat.
Because
often
it's sloppy, isn't it, the sauce?
Yeah.